Welcome to Italian Innovators. Today I'm in the company of Jessica L. Harris, Assistant Professor of History at St. John's University, scholar of African American history, women's history, and modern Italy, and author of a wonderful book, which we'll discuss today, entitled Italian Women's Experiences with American Consumer Culture, 1945-1975, The Italian Mrs. Consumer, edited by Palgrave Macmillan in 2020. Welcome, Jessica, and thanks for being with us today.
Thanks so much, Luca, for having me. I'm excited for our conversation today.
So today we'll talk about the U.S. penetration in Italian culture in the aftermath of World War II and the formation of an American influence in the country. So not only we'll discuss how the United States entered the Italian market, but also how America forged in Italy new models of behavior through film, music, fashion, and popular costume. And we'll do this starting from the perspective of women, who in your book become the focal point of a fascinating historical reconstruction. Now, in the aftermath of World War II, the United States invested heavily in the restoration of Italy's political, economic, and industrial assets. The Marshall Plan offered the country substantial aid in the reconstruction of infrastructures, yet at the same time provided a significant stimulus for the strategic development of a new market for American products and a new mass consumer-based culture in Italy. As American goods invaded the peninsula, embodying the soft power of the United States, they also brought over different models of consumption and a new lifestyle. Can you tell us something about that?
Yeah, I think what's really interesting is where you start off, Luca, is with the aftermath of World War II. And Italy and the United States were in very, very different places. The U.S. had a rapidly expanding economy, that mass consumer society, and it was a new superpower, you know, along with the Soviet Union. And really, I think what's key and most important for our discussion today about American influence is that America was the paradigm of modernity at that time. Now, in contrast, Italy was in quite dire straits. And when you really talk about consumer culture influence, and what I'm doing is looking at women, there was also a contrast in position between American women and Italian women, in that it was really a, you know, prosperity for American women versus adversity and deprivation. And so, as you mentioned, the Marshall Plan, which was financial support to Europe with the goal of creating industrial and moral recovery, Italy ends up receiving just over $1.2 billion, and it gives grants, supplies to the country too. And that really helps with launching Italy's so-called economic miracle, which marks that dramatic economic, cultural, and social transformation in the country in the late 50s. But in addition to American financial support, what you noted is the cultural commodities that are being sent from America to Italy. And focusing on female consumer culture, what you have are beauty and hygiene products, domestic appliances, specifically the refrigerator, and also two models of consumption in the department store, the glossy magazine, and also the supermarket. And so those goods and models are representatives of modernity and of also too, which is important, is you have the Cold War going on at this time of democratic consumer capitalism. So the products and models are introducing new concepts to Italy, specifically an American way of life, which proves to be quite attractive to many Italians as they look to transform and move on from the rubble and destruction that characterizes World War II and the post-war period.
So I want to expand more on this reflection, on this perspective on women that you highlighted, and really as a way to observe the phenomenon of U.S. commercial penetration in Italy, you chose this perspective of women as really the target of the U.S. democratic consumer capitalism, as the women are the key negotiators of new foreign influences, and as you call them, they are the frontline soldiers in the battle between capitalism and communism that marked the period. So how does the emergence of Mrs. Consumer allow us to see the concomitant process of Americanization of Italy?
Well, to start off, the Mrs. Consumer, the American Mrs. Consumer in this post-war period, she is the white, middle-class, suburban housewife in the U.S. And all the products and consumer models that she enjoys in her suburban home and that environment represent her, okay? And as you've noted, represent the American democratic consumer capitalism. So these products and models of how to shop, really consumer behavior that belong to this American Mrs. Consumer are being promoted to women in Italy in this post-war period with the goods that are coming, the models that are coming. And they're initially having their first impact on Italian women of the upper and upper middle classes, but then they again eventually work their way down. And so what's important is here with the American Mrs. Consumer coming over, you see the American influence in Italy on one hand, but also how that influence is being created. And there's multiple aspects to how this influence is being created. As you see, advertising is really important, specifically in popular weeklies, women's magazines in Italy, like Grazia and Annabella. And they are advertising the products, but also that American way of life, that higher standard of living, being, you know, at the forefront of technology. You also have those institutions that I've mentioned, the American model department store, the emergence of the supermarket in Italy, and also too, another way that American influence is being created is through the actions of Italian entrepreneurs themselves, who bring those American models and products that are specifically targeted to the Italian woman to Italy and create that influence. And so what you have as a result of that influence is how new ideas of womanhood based on that American Mrs. Consumer are being brought to Italian women. And one thing too I want to point out, what's really important is the power that these Italian women hold, their purchasing power, and that they are the mediators and kind of gatekeepers too of how much influence or say American consumer culture can have in Italy. And really they end up putting their own spin on American culture and kind of Italianizing it in a way.
You mentioned some of the entrepreneurs, the role of entrepreneurs in this dynamic. And in your book, you analyze in particular the impact of two Italian entrepreneurs. One is Arnoldo Mondadori and the other is Aldo Borletti. And you analyze their impact on importing the American lifestyle and creating this female customer base in Italy that you were talking about. So Mondadori purposely imitated the glossy American magazines and launched, as you mentioned, Grazia as a platform for the divulgation of a new American lifestyle. Borletti, instead, who was the owner of La Rinascente, the department store, reconstructed the store, which was bombed in 1943, and relaunched it by introducing new American styles, a display of products, or kind of the structure of the store. I wonder if you can tell us more about Mondadori and Borletti's roles in mediating cultures and internationalizing post-war Italy.
Yeah, exactly. As you put it, they really internationalized post-war Italy along American lines. And as I mentioned, they really actively seek out American culture and seek to cultivate relationships with American businesses, whether it's Mondadori with American publishing companies or with Borletti. And also, too, I'd add Umberto and Cesare Brustio, who are also at the head of La Rinascente. They seek out relationships with American retail department store companies. And so Mondadori, one of the most important publishing houses in Italy, Arnoldo Mondadori, the head, in the post-war period, really seeks to modernize not only the production process of his company's magazines, but also the magazines themselves. And of course, as I mentioned, with America being the paradigm of modernity, that's where he's going to look, across the Atlantic Ocean to the U.S. And he really does this through a variety of ways. The Marshall Plan funding, he gets some of that money and he uses it to buy U.S. printing machines. So getting that most advanced publishing and printing technology coming from the U.S. Also, too, which is a common theme between La Rinascente and Mondadori, is that they take trips to the U.S., kind of scouting trips. If you would think about, you know, professional athletics today, you know, the scouts going out to see the new talent, they go on scouting trips to the U.S. in this post-war period. Mondadori takes a trip to Time Inc., you know, the leading magazine publisher at the time. He also has other employees of his company visit Time so as to figure out, you know, the kind of directorial aspect, how the magazines are put together, so he can import them into his own publications, such as Epoca. He also establishes an office in New York to have that close contact with those American publishers, which is really, really important. And he gets Mondadori to get his publications published in the U.S. and then to get U.S. publications published in Mondadori publications. And so that's really, really key. And I think what's really the most important thing that Mondadori does is, again, building relationships with American publishing. But the U.S. politics presents him with a special opportunity. And that comes in the form of the U.S. ambassador to Italy, Claire Booth Luce, who served from 1953 to 1906. And her husband just so happens to be Henry Luce, who is the owner of Time Incorporated. So Mondadori and his representatives start mailing the duo and trying to cultivate this relationship to establish a firm connection between the two, Time and Mondadori, so as Mondadori can really incorporate the American elements into his own company's publications. And in regard to La Rinascente, they too, Aldo Borletti and Cesare and Umberto Brustio, make their own trip to the U.S. They go on a 1.5 month long visit to the U.S., traveling from East Coast to West Coast to see all these, you know, department stores, Lord & Taylor's, Macy's, Neiman Marcus, Bullock's out in Pasadena. And they go to observe the American department stores. How can they incorporate those aspects into their department stores in Italy, most notably that in Milan in the Piazza del Duomo, which had really been destroyed by the bombing in 1943. And so they're looking to rebuild, and they wanted to make La Rinascente the leader and make it the most modern. So they go to the U.S. and they observe things like the use of escalators, how the window displays are put together in U.S. department stores, the kinds of display cases and color schemes that are used in the interior. And they end up incorporating some of those elements into La Rinascente Milano Piazza del Duomo, like the escalator, which you can see to this very day. Another important thing too, in addition to the physical appearance of the La Rinascente store, is that the executives also bring American ready-to-wear fashion, which is really modern at the time. And it's in contrast to the French haute couture, which is seen as really time-consuming, handmade, expensive. And they bring the ready-to-wear American fashion, which is simple styling, it's manufactured, and it's more affordable because it's less expensive. And it really allows more women to participate in fashion. And La Rinascente signs agreements with American ready-to-wear designers to produce their own designs through their own Rinascente company. And I think that's really important in how you see these entrepreneurs bringing over the American aspects, the publishing process, magazines, the department store as well. And also they Italianize these aspects. They don't incorporate, you know, bring them over 100% as they completely are, but they choose what fits best for the Italian context. And they bring over that American culture, internationalizing post-war Italy, but also mediating it to make sure that it fits the Italian context and appeals to the Italian woman.
Thank you for bringing this up. Really, it points out what you're saying to what influence is, which in a way is a form of imitation, which is a strategic or commercial imitation, but also a cultural imitation. But at the same time, influence is also the ability to translate these models to Italianize, as you were mentioning them, so to refer them to a specific or peculiar cultural context. And really, as an example, in your research, you outline the specific case of the impact of new American commodities like refrigerators, cosmetics, hygiene products on the Italian lifestyle. And this is really one of the most fascinating aspects, in my opinion, of your research. So U.S. refrigerators, in our specific case, introduced really a revolutionary development in the country, creating new forms of food preservation and shopping. And in this context, you analyze, examine the case of an Italian entrepreneur, Giovanni Borghi, who successfully intercepted the new trend and made his fortune by adapting American-sized refrigerators to the smaller space of Italian houses. Can you tell us something about Borghi and his company, Ignis? And can you trace the impact of refrigeration upon the birth of supermarkets in Italy and also the redefinition of Italian womanhood?
Borghi really plays a key role. So the company, Giovanni Borghi's company, Ignis, which means fire in Latin, is originally formed in 1943 by his father, Guido, and his three sons, of which Giovanni was one. They start with producing small electric stoves, liquid gas cookers, mixed gas electricity ranges. And it's not until 1951 where they start their refrigerator production. And the key year here with Borghi and the refrigerator production is 1965. What happens is, again, another Italian entrepreneur traveling to the United States. He goes and visits the Frigidaire factory, an important refrigerator manufacturer in the United States, and he sees something. He sees that Frigidaire is using polyurethane foam in their refrigerators instead of mineral wool for the thermic insulation. And what's interesting here is that the polyurethane foam is normally used in roof insulation. So he thinks, oh, that's really interesting. And there's also benefits to that because by using that foam, the refrigerators can be made to be smaller in size, but still have more space in the interior. And so therefore, it's more suited for those Italian homes, which are, you know, much smaller than that typical American suburban ranch home of the time period. There's also other benefits. Using that foam is that it creates a decrease in the production costs, which makes the refrigerators less expensive, so making it more affordable for the Italian people, and also allowing for more refrigerators to be produced. And two, another interesting aspect is the incorporation of that foam allows for the complete separation of the refrigerator and freezer units, therefore allowing for food to be preserved for longer periods. And that food preservation that the refrigerator offers really redefines the mode of shopping, food shopping for Italian women, and also ideas regarding women and the homes. Their traditional food habits change because women are able to go and see things, be able to purchase food on a less frequent basis. And they can do this because they're able to go to the store and get whatever goods they might need and store it in the refrigerator for much longer times. So instead of going to a store daily and several stores too on a daily basis, women can just go, you know, maybe once or twice a week. And so they have more flexibility. But at the same time, this means they have fewer interactions with local shopkeepers with whom perhaps they've built a nice rapport and friendship. And one key thing too is also the development of the American supermarket being transferred into Italy, which again is this new retail model which has all products, food products in one location, not at multiple locations, you know, where you can go and get the fruit, vegetables, then the meat, but it's all in one location and there's many of the products, which is the abundance that represents a significant for, you know, the mass consumerism in the United States. Also, too, the supermarket introduces a self-service model where, you know, the women can go and pick out the items that they want. So fewer interactions again with the storekeepers. And then two, the selling of food products is that they're sold, quote unquote, including the service. So, you know, some of the more tedious tasks of having to, you know, prepare vegetables in a certain way or the meat in a certain way, that's done for them already when they go to the supermarket to purchase those goods. And so it cuts down on the food preparation time. So what you have here is Italian women have the supermarket that's available to them, and they can just go there once a week. They can shop, store their food in the refrigerator, will last for a week. They can plan out their meals in the week. But what's important here is a lot of the rhetoric, the discourse surrounding the refrigerator and the supermarket is that women are going to be saving time. They'll have more time for themselves with the reduced food production time, the reduced time spent on shopping. But in reality, what really happens is that the refrigerator and the way it's advertised still serves to promote that Mrs. Consumer, who is that housewife. So still tying her to the home where she's supposed to be the good mother and wife that's there to take care of the children and husband and the home and bring peace, love, and order to the home. So even though you have women who are engaging these really modern forms of food shopping and food preservation, you still see the ideas of Italian womanhood that are being promoted through women's weekly magazines, culinary magazines. They're still tied to the home. So it's a modern idea, progressive use of these appliances and new modes of shopping, but yet they're still not moving outside of the home, which I think is quite interesting.
And this is really fascinating because like refrigeration is a technology that developed like in the early 20th century and really entered the American market in the first half of the century. And Americans really introduced refrigeration in Italy also because the American market was saturated. And this introduction of a new technology really, as you were mentioning, introduced like a new concept of food shopping, the kind of territorialization of food. The longer preservation allows more global outreach of supplies to be in the stores. And this also has certainly a cultural instance of, in a way, liberation of a woman from the tie of being in the house of kind of a daily grocery shopping, but also at the same time kind of incorporating this liberation within a traditional notion of Italian womanhood, as you were mentioning, that woman in the house, the good mother, the good wife. Now, in dealing with cosmetics and hygiene, you explore in a very fascinating way the Italian appropriation of a new modern model of beauty of the American girl, which was centered on youth, sex appeal, and cleanliness. At the same time, you also investigate the post-war reconfiguration of femininity into a central political issue. So you talk about the emerging American models of womanhood as a shared enemy of both communists and Catholics. So why was the Italian woman the terminal of Italy's culture wars? Can you trace a profile of the new Italian woman in the years preceding the student turmoils of 1968 and the sexual revolution in Italy?
In regard to the beauty ideal, you have in the interwar period between the two world wars, the modern girl. She is the popular model. And once we get to after the Second World War, the popular model is that Mrs. Consumer I've been talking about. And what you find in beauty and hygiene advertisements in women's weekly magazines, for example, Annabella, is a new beauty ideal based on American notions. And those bring in new understandings and conceptions of beauty and femininity to Italy. So you see it based on a woman who's elegant and refined, yet assertive, clean, cleanliness is really important, being youthful is very important, and also being sexually self-confident, and also that she's a consuming woman engaging in this new consumer culture. And these all represent U.S. democratic consumer capitalism and its attendant ideals. For example, being modern and having a desire for personal social success really equates to individualism of U.S. democratic consumer capitalism. And so as women are starting to see more and more of these advertisements and are being promoted this American beauty ideal. Catholics and communists in Italy, with the Cold War going on, really come to see as American consumer culture representing a challenge to them and how they are trying to influence Italian women themselves. They see that this consumer culture from across the Atlantic Ocean is having a detrimental influence on Italians. So they find ways, they look for ways to respond to this challenge. So instead of solely focusing on one another, the Catholics and communists, they also turn their attention toward how to deal with American consumer culture, and in our context, female consumer culture. And what you see is specifically what I've looked at are two publications representing Catholics and communists. You have Familia Cristiana, the magazine for the Catholics, and then Noi Donne, the magazine for communists, really focused on women's culture. And you see is that in both publications, instead of completely rejecting that American female consumer culture, they decide to promote a modern consuming Italian woman, but who fits within those Catholic and communist core ideological beliefs. So for Catholics, they're afraid of that independent woman that American consumer culture and the beauty ideal promotes, and that that independent woman is going to be more detached from the family. For example, with beauty, they say, yes, you can use it, but so long as it's in an elegant mode, it's modest use of makeup, and you're promoting a Christian elegance. They want women to avoid vanity and self-indulgence. For the communists, they also adapt American consumer culture to fit their desires. They see the increasing female independence as positive, but they have more concern with capitalism and how it will distort women's financial and social morality. They're looking to promote more so collectivism and equality. So with the beauty, for example, they say, again, a modest use, a restrained use of the products. You don't want to imitate those standardized American beauty ideal that Hollywood film stars have, or that you see in the popular women's weekly magazines. You don't want to be seen as conforming to those standardized styles, because they say that in so doing, it just perpetuates the notion that women and their capabilities in society are based solely on how they look. And so they're really going against that. So against materialism, against individualism. And this is all being promoted through their respective magazines, Familia Cristiana and Noi Donne. And I think it's important too, because why is there such a focus on American female consumer culture? Is that because of this Cold War period, the intense Cold War period, it's not just a political struggle, but culture, struggle in forms of culture. And culture is seen as an avenue for turning, you know, groups of people over to one, you know, democracy or communism. And so women, who are really the targets of much of this consumer culture, are really those, as I said, the frontline soldiers. And so it's really, really significant for the Italian Catholic women and Italian communist women to try and mediate that influence themselves so as not to lose influence in Italian society.
And definitely, like, the import of, like, images, as you mentioned, some Hollywood actresses that establish models, a new form of femininity, womanhood, really become questions, issues that everybody has to deal with, in the sense that this import has to be, in a way, digested. And I think one of the most interesting cases that you brought up is really the issue of makeup, which is, of course, an industry that is developing, is producing new models, new looks, but at the same time is perceived as something, as you were mentioning, perhaps inauthentic, something not genuine for the woman. And in a way, bringing back these cultural imports to something that was a prior traditional understanding of the role of women. And in this sense, when we're discussing about influence, we are dealing with a situation where a cultural import is imitated, translated, but also generating new models and impulses. So this model of beauty and femininity that you described is also at the base of changes in the late 1960s in Europe and in Italy, brought forth by the sexual revolution. So this generates also new debates and new understanding of the modern woman.
Also, one thing to add too is, in talking about Italian women, is just as I've discussed with the entrepreneurs, is that the Italian women themselves end up mediating that American influence, whether they kind of change the ready-to-wear clothes or how they use certain aspects. And what you find is, as I said, the Italianizing of American culture and really the creation of an Italian Mrs. Consumer at this time.
And definitely it becomes a new thing, which is kind of in a way the same way as literature works. You import something from the past or from a contemporary debate, and the way literature works is to renew it by reinventing and creating new works of literature that are based on this but become then new things. So in this sense, the Mrs. Consumer imported from the United States really generates a new model of the Italian consumer, as you were mentioning. This is really a fascinating dynamic to explore from a historical and cultural perspective. And certainly I will give my contribution in an upcoming video on the reverse angle, so the Italian penetration into the American culture in the United States, the penetration of Italian models during the same years in the US. So thank you very much for this conversation. We reconstructed the impact of American industry upon Italian society in the years following the Marshall Plan and examined the intersection of marketing and culture, commerce and thought, social practices, and really their philosophy and their political impact. So starting from a female perspective, we investigated how an influence is born and how an influence can evolve into new and independent forms. So thank you, Jessica, for being with us today.
Thanks so much for having me.
And thanks everybody for watching. I invite you to subscribe to this channel if you like this video, or to the newsletter on the webpage of the show at www.italianinnovators.com to receive notifications of new episodes and know more about the project. You can also follow me on my LinkedIn profile or on Instagram at Italian Innovators for updates, news, and additional materials. Thanks again for your support. Arrivederci e alla prossima.